Hi, I'm Damon Smith, Extension Field Crops Pathologist at the University of Wisconsin-Madison.
Hi folks, Rodrigo, Werle, Extension Weed Scientist at the University of Wisconsin-Madison.
So Rodrigo, you've been getting a lot of questions lately about weed control and specifically water hemp in soybeans, right? And how are we going to control these weeds and we don't have these herbicide tools? What other things can we do?
Excellent. Yeah, so our growers, you know, most of them are doing what we're recommending them and using effective residual herbicides, layering residual herbicides, and this water hemp, it continues to challenge them, right? So traveling across the state here this month of August for our few days and so on, the one question I kept getting is, Rodrigo, what else can we be doing in a soybean year to enhance our water hemp management? And usually the one thing that comes to mind is row spacing. Mm-hmm. Most of our farmers here in Wisconsin plant their soybeans on a 30-inch row spacing, okay? You walk those fields in July, they're far from closing canopy, right, and that water hemp is still emerging. So the one thing I usually tell them, if possible, to adjust that row spacing and go narrow. We've done years of work where we compared 30 versus 15 spacing for soybeans. And what we've learned that is when we go narrow, that soybean canopy is gonna close much faster, at least 10 days sooner compared to a 30-inch, okay? And that has tremendous impact. It prevents, you know, once the canopy is closed, it's gonna slow down how fast water hemp can grow, but also prevents further water hemp from emerging. Okay, so going narrow really helps suppressing water hemp in soybeans. But then the pushback or the first question that I get from the growers, and I'm gonna bounce that back to you, is I'm concerned about white mold, Rodrigo. I don't wanna deal with narrow row spacing because I have a white mold problem. Damon.
Yeah, we've seen the same thing, you know, with white mold where, you know, if you go from a 15 to say a 30, you can actually delay the onset of white mold by 10 days, right? Hmm. So the pathogen is actually working kind of similar to how the weeds are working, but in the opposite context, right? So, you know, when we've also done some research looking at narrow versus wide row spacing, and we were kind of surprised to do that research because what we learned is that actually you can move to the 15-inch row spacing and be okay in terms of white mold management. The key though is to drop that planting population. Hmm. And we're talking about 100,000 seeds per acre thereabouts, right? So pretty low planting populations, but you know, I've talked with and worked with Dr. Sean Conley on this, our agronomist, and you know, he's fully on board with this. These modern soybean varieties can compensate for those lower planting populations. So I think this is a nice balance, if you would agree.
Yes.
I think it's a nice balance, you know, where we can capture that 15-inch row spacing, you know, work with the water hemp issues that we have, and then still balance that with the white mold issues that we have in some of these fields in the state.
That's excellent, because that would be a win-win scenario. We go narrow for the water hemp, but dropping that seeding rate helps with the white mold. The following question that I usually get is, because we're always comparing 30 to 15, at least in the research that we do because of the equipment we have, what if a grower, instead of a 15, they have either 22, 20 row spacing planter, or perhaps they're using a drill and a 7.5, 10 inches, Damon, would your recommendation still remain the same?
Yep, still the same. We're actually seeing a dropping of planting population across all the row spacings being a pretty positive thing. So I would stick with that across, you know, all those different spans. Even at 30s, we're seeing positive effects with even dropping the planting population there. The issue there in the 30s is you start to have this push and pull of yield, and so you have to be a little careful in the really wide row spacings there. The other thing to consider is you don't have to go across the whole farm and do this. You know, in the context of white mold, you could just concentrate on the areas where you have high levels of white mold and drop those planting populations there. But maybe keep the planting populations up or even go a little higher in the areas where you don't have white mold, or capture prescriptive planting technology. So if you have that on your planter, you could drop it in those high white mold areas, or you know, increase the planting population in the areas where you have high yield and little white mold.
That's excellent. Just putting our agronomic knowledge and our precision tools out there to work, right?
Right, right. And trying to balance all these pest issues. So
fantastic.
If you'd like to learn more about weed issues, you have a website, Rodrigo?
Yep, folks can go to whiskweeds.info.
And if you'd like to learn more about disease and specifically white mold, badgercropdoc.com. And of course, you can always visit your local extension educator.